All right, we are continuing the study of the book of Revelation. You can go to chapter 2. Some really interesting things here. It's always fun to put these studies together because it's, you know, I'm learning, you know, Lord's teaching me things and then I get to teach you. So it's a great blessing. Let's begin in verse 1. Looking at Ephesus. Revelation chapter 2, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Interesting. Keep your hand there in Revelation chapter 2, and turn back to Matthew chapter 22. I want to show you something interesting here about this thing of stars. As I said in the last study, stars in your King James Bible are a reference to angels. So you want to see some supernatural activity, go outside in a nice clear night and look up. Matthew chapter 22, verse 28 through 30. The story there given about these Pharisees and things, or Sadducees, I guess it was, verse 23 talks about it. They come to, wouldn't have been the Pharisees because they did believe in the resurrection. Sadducees did not. But they came to Jesus tempting him, trying to trap him intellectually. I mean, real smart thing to do there, to God manifest in the flesh, you know, like you have a chance. But they come and they're trying to trap him, and they talk about this man that had a wife, and then he dies, and then his brother gets her to marry, and then, you know, and all the brothers die, and, you know, and everything. And so we'll pick up here in verse 28. It says, Therefore in the resurrection, whose wife shall she be of the seven? For they all had her. Now, I don't know if there's a whole lot to this, but I saw that and I thought of the seven. How many stars do we have there? Angel of the church of Ephesus, write these things, saith he that holdeth the seven stars. Seven. Kind of an interesting little tie in here. Verse 29. Jesus answered and said unto them, Ye do err, not knowing the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. Thought that was kind of interesting there. You know, could that have been a little bit of a subtle reference to what would come later on there with the seven churches? You know, that there are seven, you know, brethren there. I don't know. I just thought that was kind of an interesting thing, you know. It's a kind of unique thing. But notice there that in the resurrection, it says there they are as the angels of God in heaven. Okay? Now we can next go to John chapter 10. John chapter 10. Now this one is interesting. Okay? The other one is kind of, I don't know. Just thought that was kind of interesting there, you know, the thing about the seven. But John chapter 10, this definitely is a tie-in here. John 10 verse 27 through 30 says, My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. Wait a second there. This must be a contradiction because he says, Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. Next verse, no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. What's going on there? Keep reading. Verse 30, I and my Father are one. Yes, Jesus was God. Was and is God, I might add. But isn't it interesting? In the resurrection, we are as the angels of God. All right. What is going on back there in the book of Revelation chapter 2? The seven stars. If you go back to Revelation chapter 2, keep your finger there in John chapter 10. Revelation chapter 1, verse 20. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand. Remember what we just read in John 10? And the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. In the resurrection, we are angels. Or as the angels, if you want to say it that way. That's what the Bible says. So, were like, you know, basically angels in the resurrection. And it's interesting too, another study I might end up doing in the future is the thing of the angels in the book of Revelation. There's some very unique things about them, but I don't want to get ahead of myself there. But whereas the angels in the resurrection, there are seven stars in the Lord's hand. And in John chapter 10, if you look back at there, verse 29, well, actually verse 28, Jesus says, no man's able to pluck them out of my hand. Verse 29, no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. Isn't that something? So the stars are angels, and they're in the right hand of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God. So it's a kind of a handy place to be as a Christian. A little corny joke there, but you know, it truly is. It's a great thing to know that we are in our Father's hand. Pretty neat. But now let's go back to Revelation chapter 2. We're going to go on to the next one here. Get a little bookmark thing here. Verse 2. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. They were pretty judgmental, it sounds like. We're going to see about that. But how did the verse start out? I know thy works. You mean to tell me the Lord would judge churches based on their works? You know, that's what I've always advocated. Repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Good works will follow true conversion. You don't have to do the works to stay saved or to be saved. You do the works because you are saved. Something happens in your life. There's a change. So isn't it weird that the Lord comes here and he says, I know thy works. It's almost like God's looking at the works of people that are saved. Like that's important to him. It's important to the Lord, but it shouldn't be important to us, because it's just, salvation is just simply a profession of faith that you believe that Jesus died for your sins, but no works have to follow that. Kind of weird. You say, well, that's just the one church though, brother. You know, just the one church. Okay, jump down to verse 9 of the same chapter, Revelation chapter 2, verse 9. I know thy works. Smyrna. Go down to verse 13. Pergamos. I know thy works. Jump down to verse 19 of Thyatira. I know thy works. Go to chapter 3, verse 1. Sardis, you have, I know thy works. Verse 7. Well, excuse me, verse 8. Chapter 3, verse 8. Verse 7, it says about Philadelphia. Verse 8, I know thy works. Verse 14, chapter 3, verse 14. The angel of the church of the Laodiceans. Verse 15, I know thy works. So all seven churches are judged according to their works. And you know, it's very funny, because I've seen a lot of these people that talk about salvation being just a belief, just a profession of faith, and no works have to follow, and you know, whatever. And they get all philosophical about, you know, well, if somebody's saved, they could technically, and they do all this stuff. Just ignore the plain teachings of Scripture, you know. But they'll do this thing where a lot of them, they'll go post-trib or pre-trib or pre-wrath, post-trib, whatever. They get into all this stuff. And almost all of them will eliminate the judgment seat of Christ. Something about they don't want their works being judged. You see, they want to have that profession of faith. They want to say, I'm a Christian, but they want to be able to do what they want. They don't want anybody telling them what to do. Which is the exact reason a lot of lost people don't get saved. The changed life kind of scares them a little bit. I thought that was very interesting, very telling. Titus chapter 1. Turn to Titus chapter 1. Should we judge people according to their works? Titus 1 verse 16, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. Oh, sure. Don't tell me that everybody out there that professes to be a Christian is saved. Don't even tell me about it. I know better. All right? And I'm not a heretic because I say there has to be good works that follow true conversion. And let me just speak real frankly here. The time is coming when playtime is going to be over. Okay? We're going to have to start judging Christians according to their works. Oh, yeah. Things are getting real dangerous very, very quickly. But notice back in verse 2 of Revelation chapter 2, it talks about that they, you know, are trying people and they're judging people basically, you know, about the thing of apostles, and they've has found them to be liars, you know. What about that? Well, the church was Ephesus, so why don't we turn to Ephesians? Ephesians chapter 5. I'm going to show you some interesting tie-ins here. Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 1, it says, "Be ye therefore followers of God and as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also hath loved us and hath given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling savor. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not be once named among you as becometh saints, neither filthiness nor foolish talking nor jesting, which are not convenient, but rather giving of thanks. For this ye know, that no whoremonger, nor unclean person, nor covetous man who is an idolater, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not ye therefore partakers with them. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light." Sounds like there's a changed life there. "Ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord." Verse 9, "For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth." Truth. That's the very most important thing that you have as a Christian. Verse 10, "Proving what is acceptable unto the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light, for whatsoever doth make manifest is light." Okay? It sounds almost like Paul put some standards upon the church at Ephesus. Yeah. And by the way, you say, well, that was just, you know, for the church of Ephesus. Those aren't standards for us today. Yes, they are. I mean, you go through the Pauline epistles, you apply that stuff to you today. And anything in the Gospels and anything in the Old Testament that doesn't contradict what goes on in the Pauline epistles. These are our marching orders, so to speak, the Pauline epistles. But the things that are written aforetime are written for our learning. All right? You can read through the rest of the Bible, the whole Bible, and you'll see doctrines that overlap and see things that overlap that God never changed. And God did not tell Paul, hey, rewrite that, don't tell me I don't have to do that, whatever else. Your responsibility as a Christian is to study the Word of God. But let's go back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 3. "And hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted." Oh boy. How many of you are about ready to faint? The labor's getting kind of wearying, isn't it? I mean, especially you get on YouTube and it's just like you get online and things where people can attack you. And I mean, it's vexing in person too, but it can get very vexing here online. But what's the advice there? "Well, for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted." Is there some tie in there to a Pauline epistle? Yes. Keep your finger there and go back to Galatians. The book of Galatians, chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. Remember that, by the way. All these atheists, they come, they mock God, and they mock the Bible, and mock all this stuff. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption, but he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap, if we faint not. And I'm going to show you here in a little bit what happens when you faint. Because you can faint as a Christian. You can give up. You can get messed up and go right back into the world. And you'll never go back into the world in the sense of just blending in and fitting in and just kind of, you know, you see these people, I used to be a Christian, but now I'm an atheist or something. They were never Christians, okay? A Christian that is a true Bible-believing, saved, born-again, you know, child of God, you're never going to fit into this world again. Doesn't matter how hard you try, you'll never make it, okay? All you'll do is just wreck your life, okay? More on that here in a little bit. But let's go back to Revelation chapter 2. You know, it's a difficult thing sometimes to think of. But, you know, I don't know how long we have to go yet. I mean, I've been saying, you know, the Lord's got to come back any time here. And you know, he keeps waiting. Why? Well, because he's long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He's waiting. He's patiently waiting for somebody out there to get saved. I believe that that's the reason why we haven't left yet. I mean, the Lord has this whole thing worked out. He knows. He knows it all. But he could have taken us out of here, and he hasn't. Somebody has to get saved. That's what I believe. But look at verse 4, Revelation 2, verse 4. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Huh. Have you ever been in love? I mean, really, really, really head over heels in love with somebody? What do you do? Well, all you can think about is them. You get distracted with your normal life because you're thinking about the one that you love. And you just want to talk about the one that you love all the time with anybody that you meet, including you get around family or friends or whoever, and they start getting irritated at you because all you want to talk about is the person that you're in love with. You know? I mean, that's how it was before I got married. It's like all I could think about was my wife. You know, she wasn't my wife at the time, but, you know, we'd talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk for hours and hours and hours, and it was like still not enough, you know? I just couldn't think of anything better than just to have her there by my side. Because I was in Pennsylvania, she was out in Iowa at the time. So, but it was just like I was consumed with her. Isn't that the way it's supposed to be when we first get saved? Let me ask you a very prying question. Is that the relationship that you still have with Jesus? Or have things cooled off a bit? Has your relationship kind of mellowed a little bit? Very rough question, one that I have to ask myself. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. I see some very interesting tie-ins here. We are the bride of Christ. We are supposed to be married to Him. He's our husband, spiritually speaking, of course, obviously. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord. Now, that's supposed to be followed by women that are married to saved husbands like that, you know, certainly. But let me ask you a question, Christian, man or woman. Do you submit yourself to the will of Jesus Christ? If the Lord tells you to give up something or tells you to stop doing something or tells you to whatever, do you submit to Him? I find myself, one of the weirdest things I struggle with is I listened to secular music for years and years and years and years and years before I got saved, all different types of music and things. And there are so many times I'll be driving someplace by myself or doing some work or whatever else, and I'll start singing a secular song. And, you know, the ones that I sing aren't necessarily bad. You know, it's just going through my head. It's an old tune. I liked old bluegrass music and things. And there's a lot of times the Lord will just simply say, that song you're singing isn't glorifying me. Why don't you spend your time glorifying me with some hanging, simming, singing some hymns. And, you know, I have to stop and I just go, okay, yeah, get the song out of your head. Okay, now sing a hymn. Okay, sing praise to the Lord. I mean, what am I doing spending my time singing just secular music that has no meaning at all eternally? And it's hard. It's hard. I mean, there's times I'm like, I got stuff to do today, you know, and I get up in the morning and I'm looking at the Bible and just going like, you know, my mind's going a million miles an hour on work that I have to get done. And I'm just like, and I look at the chapter and I'm going, oh man, it's got like 50 verses in it. Have you left your first love, Christian? Do you submit yourself to your husband in heaven? Verse 23, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, get back to that in a minute, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. The quickest way to ruin your walk with the Lord, the quickest way for you to get out of fellowship with the Lord, for you to fall out of that first love type of feeling, that first love relationship, the fastest way is for you to do this and put it down and walk away. It will not take you very long. I mean, within a couple days, you will feel that separation happening. You have to have this book in a prominent place in your life. You have to give time to the Word of God. Why? That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the Word. Let me just put it to you another way. Be a little blunt here, okay? I'm sure that you're all shocked that I'm going to be blunt. But here we go. What would happen if you went for a week without bathing? Any kind of bathing. Do you think that you'd be a pleasant person to be around? How about a month? You say, yeah, that'd be pretty bad. You wouldn't wash yourself in water for a month. Our text there said in Ephesians 5:26 about cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. You'll get kind of stinky as a Christian when you don't get washed by this book. Interesting tie-in. Let's keep reading here. Verse 28. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself. For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church. You know, the best way for you to stay in good health, and I'm talking physically now, I'm not even talking spiritually, physically, the best way for you to stay in good health is to have a right relationship with the Lord. And the Lord will tell you what to do. He'll say, no, don't eat that junk food. Hey, why don't you go for a walk? Hey, why don't you get to bed instead of sitting up watching all kinds of videos and things? That's a problem I have. I want to see sermons and I want to catch up on what, you know, this is happening and that's happening and what, you know, World War III and this is on the horizon and that's in the Mark of the Beast stuff and whatever. I get drawn into that stuff, you know. And it's just like the Lord will just say, he brings that conviction and says, hey, get to bed. All right. Don't eat that. Get some exercise. Whatever. Why is he doing that? He's nourishing and cherishing cherishing us as his bride. Verse 30, for we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. If we fall out of proper nutrition and proper health, we make the Lord look bad. We really do. And I'm not saying you have to be some kind of bodybuilder, whatever else, you know, perfect condition and things. You're going to struggle with your flesh. Of course you will. You're going to have some issues and things, some health problems now and then. Sure, absolutely. But you got to be careful. Keep under your body and bring it into subjection. Verse 31, for this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. Do you reverence Jesus Christ? Do I reverence Jesus Christ? Do we forget sometimes that he's a king? Go back to Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, verse 5. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent. Repent. And do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. You can make a mess of your life. You can wreck your life as a Christian, as I've said. Now, I had somebody ask in the comments, or the guest book, I guess it was, on my website, KingJamesVideoMinistries.com. They said, if you're a reprobate, if you kind of go reprobate as a Christian, and you feel really out of fellowship with the Lord, can you come back? Can you come back from a reprobate mind? Well, if you're saved, yes, absolutely. I mean, there are false conversions out there, and I would encourage, if you're watching this, I would encourage, you know, examine yourself, whether you be in the faith. Let me show you that verse actually real quickly here, because this is very important, very interesting tie-in. 2 Corinthians, go there. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5 says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith, prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves, how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates? You know, it's an interesting thing, and I'd have to really look into it a lot more, the exact meaning of reprobate and things, and can you come back from, you know, God giving you up, God giving you over to a reprobate mind, and you can get into the argument there. But the fact of the matter is, if you are concerned about your relationship with Jesus Christ, I don't think that you've fully become a reprobate. I think that you are more listed here in like a, you know, Church of Ephesus type of a Christian, where you've kind of left your first love, and the Lord right now is saying, repent. Remember from therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works. Notice again, it isn't just, you know, oh God, I'm sorry, I you know, man, I'm out of shape, and I've been eating all this junk food, and it's affecting my mind, and I'm on medication now and things like this, and medication's like majorly toxic, whole other story. But and you know, I haven't read my Bible in a while, and I got myself in debt, and I got this and I got that, and oh man, I'm sorry, you know, please forgive me. Lord will forgive you, but there has to be works involved. You see, things have to change. Otherwise, you're going to continue in the same rut. You understand? I mean, you have to say, I put the Bible down. I haven't been reading the Word of God like I should be, and I don't know what to do. Let me get the wording exactly right here. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. What happened? Pick the Bible back up again, open it up, dust it off, you know, if you have to, and get back to reading it. Well, okay, I guess I could kind of slowly get in. No. Get back to where it was when you fell. You got to become a fanatic if you want to get that relationship restored. Very important. 1 John. on the subject of the thing of coming back to the Lord, remembering from where you've fallen and returning. 1 John chapter 1, verses 9 and 10 says, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us." We all have sins. We all have things that we struggle with. I don't care how sanctified of a Christian you are, you still are struggling with something. Okay? You first get saved, and sometimes when you're first saved, it seems like this huge mountain in front of you, and you're going, "Oh, there's just so much stuff to learn. There's so many things I have to give up, and so many things I have to change, and so much is happening, and whatever." Yeah, you're going to go through that time. You will go through some rough times. But if you remain faithful to the Lord, He'll help you through it, and He'll give you great blessings. Romans 8:28 says that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Now, think about that. If I tell you everything is going to work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. In other words, if you're messing around, that promise is not for you. Okay, everything's going to go downhill. But if you're doing right, all things are working together for good. You get more and more blessings the farther you go as a Christian. You understand? Things will get better and better and better. And I'm going to tell you right now, I am living proof of that. I went through some very, very hard times when I first got saved. You say, "Well, you don't go through hard times anymore?" Oh, yes, I still go through hard times, but not like what I used to go through. Now I see the power of God in my life, and I see the Lord doing amazing things, just miraculous. Like, wow. And I think to myself, you know, I want to see the Lord, but man, I'm thinking, you know, what's it going to be like in another couple years? What's the Lord going to be doing through this ministry? How's the Lord going to be blessing us? I'm excited for both possibilities. I mean, you listen to a lot of my old preaching. You can hear the kind of the misery that was in me and things as a single guy, you know. And it's like, I'll never, by God's grace, I will never take my eyes off of looking for Jesus Christ to take us out of here. Sure. But I'm seeing some amazing, amazing miracles happen in our life. I'll just give you a little example. We were kind of in a little bit of a slump here, money-wise. Our car died, essentially, and we had to sell it, and we had to get another vehicle. And we didn't get anything, you know, new or anything, so don't get excited. We went from a 1999 to a 1979 vehicle, so we like older vehicles. But definitely not a very expensive vehicle. It's going to need some work and whatever. But the whole point is, we spent a lot of the money that we had, which wasn't a whole lot. And we have some projects that we're trying to get done and everything. And I said to my wife in the morning, I said, you know, it's going to take, and I gave a dollar amount, and I said, to really get us back on our feet. And I was just like, Lord, you know what we need. And that was it. A couple hours later, we go to the post office, and there's a donation, and it is literally between the two amounts that I had stated what we needed to get back on our feet again. And I'm just like, wow. To the person out there that sent the donation, thank you very much for that. There was no name, there was no anything like that, so I can't write and thank you, but we received it. Thank you. A very wonderful blessing from the Lord. And it was interesting because we prayed when we got this donation, and we said, Lord, please bless, you know, whoever it was that sent this. It was just amazing timing. And I said, Lord, I just want to rededicate our lives to You. And I just want to say, Lord, no matter what truth You show us, we'll bring it out. If You're there with us, if You're standing behind us, we will never back down on any kind of truth that You show us. We'll bring it out, no matter what it costs us. And the next 24 hours, the Lord showed us just earth-shattering information. We're compiling stuff right now, putting things together. It's unreal, some of the stuff the Lord showed us. Interesting things coming out in the future. Something else I need to mention too, the big study that I talked about for a while. We've had to kind of take a break from that for a little bit of time. I can't get into a whole lot of details, but we're restructuring a lot here. And so we've had to take a break because it was like just majorly time consuming. There's just so much material that we have to go through and study and everything else. So it will be coming out eventually. But some difficult things there. But getting back to what we were saying here, if you want to go next to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the thing about judging yourself, the thing about examining yourself, you know, if you've gotten out of fellowship with the Lord, you can come back. Okay? I don't believe a Christian can get to a point of having a reprobate mind, in all honesty. I think that reprobate minds are reserved for the people that are lost. And again, you know, I'd have to do more study on that before I can be very definitive, but I believe that when you have a Christian that's gotten away from the Bible, that's listening to the wrong music, eating the wrong foods, doing the wrong things with their life, I think it's that they've left their first love, and they can repent from that and do the first works. Okay, let's read here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28 through 32. It says, this is talking about the thing of communion. It says, "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep." These are Christians that have left their first love. "For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged." But now look at verse 32. "But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." When you get saved, your relationship to God changes. Okay? Before your salvation, you are a child of the devil. You are of the world. All right? When you get saved, when God saves you, okay? Make sure God saved you, by the way. You know, I have a profession. I believe that I've... Okay, but did God save you? Have you been born again? That's very important. Do you have God's Holy Spirit of truth in your life, bearing witness to the things I'm saying to you? You better. But you see, when you have that relationship with the Lord and you judge yourself, you're judging yourself now as the bride of Jesus Christ. Also, you know, there's many types in the Bible and things. We are His bride. We are also His children, God's children. All right? We're the bride of Jesus Christ. We are God the Father's children. Just like Jesus is the Son and things. And you say, explain all that stuff. I can't explain all that stuff. A lot of things about, you know, God and the Bible and things, it's eternal. It's spiritual things that we're going to understand when we get to heaven. And we aren't going to understand it down here in our mortal bodies. But then again, you don't have to understand everything in the Bible. Just believe it. But you see again there, what do you do when you leave your first love? Well, if you judge yourself, then you won't be judged. God gives us standards in His Word whereby you can judge yourself. You know, another place of Scripture talks about the Bible is like a looking glass, like a mirror, essentially, that you can judge yourself. You can look into this book and you can say, oh, wow, that verse convicts me there. Boy, I'm doing that or I'm not doing that. If it's a command, I better change. Yeah. Well, let's continue. Back to Revelation chapter 2, verse 6. It says here, "But this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate." Oh, God's such a hate criminal, I guess, apparently. I mean, this hate criminal stuff, hate speech, hate, you know, this. I did this thing about hate preachers and things like that. It's ridiculous. It's absurd. It is Orwellian doublethink is what, you know, I mean, somebody's guilty of hate speech. Okay, do you hate their hate speech? Well, their hate speech should be punishable, you know. So then you hate what they're doing. Wait a second. If you love their hate speech, then you wouldn't be going after them for hate speech. So you have to hate their hate speech, but then you're guilty of hate as well. Woo. Craziness. We are supposed to hate evil as Christians. But notice there it says, "This thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans." It's the deeds that we hate. But what's a Nicolaitan? Well, a Nicolaitan is somebody who seeks to rule over laity, a man in authority that seeks to lord over people. I'm going to show you some good scriptures on this. 1 Peter, turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. First Peter chapter 5, verse 1. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Okay, Peter just counts himself as one of the elders. Interesting. Verse 2. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. Neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. Oh boy, there you go. You're not supposed to be a lord. You're not supposed to be a Nicolaitan. Somebody who's up above the laity. The simple, uneducated people down there. You're not supposed to do that. Verse 4, and when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. There's the works being judged, you know. Likewise, ye younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another. And be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. You will be exalted at the judgment seat of Christ. You will be given crowns of reward, and nobody's going to be able to gainsay nor resist that. Nobody's going to be able to come and say, hey, I don't agree. Come on, Jesus. You shouldn't have given him that reward. No. When you hit the judgment seat of Christ and your works are tried by fire, whatever rewards, whatever things make it through that fire, you earned it. And nobody's going to be able to gainsay nor resist that. Nobody's going to be able to say, oh, come on. You earned it. He will exalt you in due time. But there's another application to it. Millennial inheritance. If we suffer, we shall reign with him. He will exalt you in due time. Go next to 2 Timothy chapter 2. Show you what a good preacher will do. This is a challenge to me. I try my best to do this. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, and the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Now, that's very, very instructive. Okay? Our job, when you get saved, you go into a time of outpouring of truth. I have seen this thing so many times. I will not judge somebody who has the Spirit of truth come upon them. I see that thing happen and they're just like, give me truth. They're just absorbing. They're just like a sponge and they just want to talk about the Bible and they're just like, I'm researching this and researching that, and they're just like, oh, I want to learn more. You know, the Holy Spirit's come upon them. When I see somebody and they're just like, oh, caught up in the emotion and, oh, Jesus died for me, and oh, they can cry and everything else, and you say, yeah, that's praise Lord, you know, I guess, are you saved? Oh, yes, I'm saved. Oh, God saved me. Oh, and stuff. And you say, well, the King James Bible is actually God's Word. These other, you know, new versions are from the Vatican. And you see that saved Christian and they go, well, I don't know about that. I don't really think. And you say, well, could I show you some truth on it? No, I'm not interested in that. Okay. You know, that music you're listening to, could you turn that down, please? That's kind of worldly. It's kind of giving me, you know, the creeps. Oh, I like that music. What's wrong with my music? And then you see their countenance start to change, and it's, who are you to judge me? I'm a Christian, you know. Okay. See? It's a problem. But when I see, when I see that, I'm just like, okay, you know, whatever, you know, oh, you're a Christian. Okay, whatever. I doubt that. But when I see a Christian and they have that Spirit of truth, they have that desire for truth, my job as a preacher, God has put me into this ministry. I've been in this now for quite a few years. And my goal, my desire is to put together sermons and preaching and teaching so I can give it to you. I want to leave you with a book, with a final authority that's not me. Here you go. Why? Because I want you to take what you've learned here at this ministry and go teach other people. You see, I'm trying to bring you up to my level. And some of you go above me yet. Some of you will get into subjects and study things that I haven't had time to study or just don't have the brains for it or whatever else. Praise the Lord. Why on earth would I want to lord over people? Why would I want to keep you down? Doesn't make any sense. I'll tell you a little story here just to kind of illustrate the point. I remember the one time I was going to a Baptist church, Mount Zion Baptist Church in Denver, Pennsylvania. Pastor Keith Schweitzer was the pastor at the time. I guess he's still there. I have no idea. But I remember that there was a woman, and she was married to a man in a wheelchair. And I remember he had this thing. You could ask questions at the end of this one thing that he did, Sunday school lesson or whatever. And she raises her hand, and he says, yes, you know, whatever, Sister so-and-so. I can't remember what her name was. And she said, I know a Buddhist. One of my friends is into Buddhism and things. And she asked me this question, what makes your belief system different than mine? And he was like, well, you know, that's a very detailed question. And we have, you know, these things that you can come and you can do this study and whatever else. They had like Bible study nights, and we could probably get into it then or something. And I thought to myself at the time, I remember sitting there and I was just like brand new saved. I was very green, making a lot of mistakes. But I thought to myself, you can't answer that question? What makes us different as Christians? I can answer that thing in 5 seconds. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives. He lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. How long did that take? Jesus Christ is alive. I know Him personally. He speaks to me through His word, precious promises in His word. We've been given a more sure word of prophecy. What did Buddha do for you? Well, that's right. He died. Did Buddha come up from the grave? No. What makes Christianity different? We serve a risen Savior. That's an old hymn, by the way, if you don't know that. I didn't just make that up. You know, look it up. It's called He Lives, I think is what the name of the hymn is. But, you know, but see, what's he trying to do? Well, he's trying to keep the people down. Seminary educated, Bob Jones University, the whole thing, you know. And, you know, you just... you got to be careful to give people, you know, you don't want to give them too much information and things, kind of a deal. What is that? Nicolaitanism. Yeah, sure. You know, and again, the old Baptist church thing, you know, you got to get into the inner circle, the inner clique there so that you can get, you know, be one of the pastor's pets and he calls you out from the pulpit, you know, jokes with you and whatever else, and the other people that are in the inner circle and stuff like this. It's carnal. Wicked. But let's get back to Revelation, chapter 7, excuse me, chapter 2, verse 7. Every time I do a sermon, I'm trying for that papal infallibility, but it just never happens. I'm just always making mistakes. It's just... Revelation chapter 2, verse 7. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Uh-oh. Okay, now, here's where it gets interesting. As I said in the introduction, there are some things in the book of Revelation that doctrinally are very iffy for a Christian. Let me show you what's going on here. Keep your hand in Revelation chapter 2 and go back to Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22. What is this thing about the tree of life? Revelation chapter 22, verse 14. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Blessed are they that do his commandments? Works? Yeah, pure works. There's not even any faith involved in that. Doing his commandments. Who's it written to? Well, I believe Revelation chapter 22, verse 14 is written to people in the millennial kingdom. People that have gone through that time period. So what's going on back here in Revelation chapter 2, verse 7? Do we need the tree of life? No, we get our eternal life from Jesus Christ. You say, what is that? It's not my dispensation, brethren. I can try to make mental gymnastics, and I can look at commentaries, and I can look at this man says that, and this, and I went to the Greek, and I'm not going to do it. I'm going to tell you, I am a preacher from the Pauline epistles back in there. Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. You know? I don't know. I've gotten into debates with some of the brethren on this whole thing because, you know, for a long time I kind of held to the position that, you know, Revelation chapters 2 and 3, the seven churches, were seven local churches in Asia Minor during the first century that John was writing to. And it can also be applied to seven periods in church history, seven types of churches, seven types of Christians, you know, these seven churches. And I kind of held to that for a while. And then I had some brethren bring up, you know, there's some stuff written to these seven churches that appears almost like it's seven churches in the time of Jacob's trouble. And I can't totally discount that. And that's why I'm just like, I don't know. I have no idea. I am not here, though, to teach the doctrines of the book of Revelation. I am here to apply some things in Revelation as instruction in righteousness for us as Christians today. What goes on in this time period and what this stuff is all written to, and back to the minor prophets in the Old Testament and some of the other things going on, I'll be the first to tell you, it's right over my head. It's just not going to be revealed to me. Why? I'm not going to be here for the time period. So, but you know, instruction in righteousness, you're going to see this thing also. You see their works being judged, all the seven churches, and you're going to see this thing of to him that overcometh. There's special rewards. Now, can I apply that to a Christian today as instruction in righteousness? Oh, absolutely. You're going to have to overcome certain things in your life. You're going to have to overcome what people think of you. You're not going to have to, you know, you're not going to be able to care about that stuff. You're going to have to be an overcomer with that and get above it, you see. You're going to have to overcome some health issues. You're going to have to overcome financial issues and whatever else. The Lord's going to put you through some trials and testing down here. You're going to suffer a little bit. So yeah, instruction in righteousness, yeah, I can see Christians are also going to have to overcome. But doctrine? Let's continue. Revelation chapter 2, verse 8. And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. Another good verse to use on Jehovah's Witnesses. The first and the last. That's a reference to God. He represents eternity. He's the first, the beginning of the creation, and he is the last. He's there at the end. Okay? But he was dead. And he's alive. We serve a risen Savior. Not a created being like the Jehovah's Witnesses teach. They teach that Michael the Archangel somehow was, you know, became Jesus, and then he was here on, you know, and he died on a torture stake, not a cross. And then he kind of went back up and he became Michael the Archangel again or something like this. Nutty nonsense. Interesting, too, because the founder of the Jehovah's Witness cult, Charles Taze Russell, was a 33rd degree Mason and very heavily into the occult. He had a big thing for pyramids and things like that. He was an occultist. But let's continue. Verse 9. Another real good one here. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. Stop there. You mean you can be poor and yet rich at the same time? Yeah. Got to turn my page here with my notes that I have written. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. The book of 2 Corinthians chapter 8. I'll show you a good group of people that were very poor and yet rich. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 1. Let's begin there. Moreover, brethren, we do you to wit of the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, how that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded unto the riches of their liberality. For to their power I bear record, yea, and beyond their power they were willing of themselves, praying us with much entreaty that we would receive the gift and take upon us the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And this they did, not as we hoped, but first gave their own selves to the Lord and unto us by the will of God. Now, you know, it's an impressive thing when you have the Apostle Paul saying, hey, I bear record of the power of those people. Paul is saying that? All these amazing things that have happened through the Apostle Paul, and he's looking at the people over in Macedonia, and he's saying, I bear record of the power of those people, the spiritual power over there. Why? Because they were poor and yet rich. And you'll see that theme repeated throughout the Bible, you know, this thing of being poor, laying up for yourselves treasures in heaven, not on the earth. Yeah. Again, another challenge there. Where are your priorities? But let's go back to Revelation chapter 2. We'll finish the verse there. Revelation chapter 2, verse 9. Revelation 2, verse 9, the second part there. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. Now, there's all the arguments, you know. The synagogue of Satan. What's the synagogue of Satan? Well, people that meet in synagogues are Jews, therefore they have to be the synagogue of Satan. How does that work? They say they are Jews and are not. So that would disqualify them being labeled as the synagogue of Satan. Why? They are Jews. You know? And, you know, the replacement theology people, they come out and they say, well, you know, Israel has been replaced, the Jews have been replaced by the church, and so now we are the Jews. No, you're actually the synagogue of Satan. That's what it's talking about there. Why? Well, let me prove it to you. The true Jews that we have in the Bible, they will inherit land promised to them according to Galatians chapter 4, verse 30. You can read it. There is land, the Abrahamic covenant, the land that God promised to Abraham and to his seed. And you read in the passage there, it's not given to Ishmael, the child that was born as a result of Abraham going in unto his Egyptian handmaiden, Hagar, and they bore this, you know, son Ishmael. But he doesn't get the land. You can, again, I mean, this is New Testament. Okay, this is not, well, the Old Testament. This is New Testament for a Christian in the church age. Galatians 4, towards the end of the thing there, but specifically verse 30, talks about, well, let's, you know what, let's just go there. Let's go there. And you can pause it and whatever else and go and read it, but I know, you know, you can kind of get caught into the thing and you say, well, I'm just going to, you know, I'll remember to do that at the end of the study, and then you get to the end of the study and you end up forgetting. Galatians chapter 4, verse 30. Nevertheless, what saith the Scripture? Cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. New Testament, okay? They still get land over there. So when you see all this arguments over the Palestinians, you know, the Palestinians have a right to that land. No, they don't. Why? Palestinians are descended from the son of the bondwoman. They have no right to that land. And if you're saved and you're a Palestinian, you need to get off the land. You have no right to be there. That land belongs to the Jews. It's very important. And again, like I said, you know, you can read Galatians chapter 4 there. It's talking about the physical descendants of Abraham and Sarah through Isaac. But what is this thing here in Revelation? Go back there, Revelation chapter 2, verse 9. I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. People will argue over who the Jews are and whatever else, but what about the blasphemy? What's the blasphemy there? I mean, how does God get blasphemed through this whole thing? Very simple. If God gives the land to somebody else, and by the way, the Vatican, I don't know if a lot of you are even aware of this, but the Vatican owns Jerusalem. It was given to them back in 1993, I think it was. How about that? You know what that is? Blasphemy. Why? Because if they get the land, if they keep the land, and God never gives it to the Jews, God's a liar. And the Bible identifies Satan as a liar, father of lies. God cannot lie, according to the book of Titus. So the blasphemy there is somebody coming in and saying, I'm the Jews, and this is my land. Exactly as the Vatican does, and all who teach replacement theology. It's a very dangerous thing to get into. Very dangerous. And you can read the comments, or read the over in Revelation, or Romans chapter 11. Very dangerous to mess around with the Jews and their land. And by the way, you know, the quickest way to tell if these people that come out and they say, we're the true Jews. You know, there's a lot of black people that do that, you know. And a lot of, they say, well, the blacks, you know, from Africa and some of the tribes over there. Not all of them, but, you know, some are Hamites, some are Shemitic. How does that work? But they say, you know, well, you know, some of the black Africans that are here in America now, you know, and a lot of the Native Americans and some of the other people and things, they're the Jews. They're the Jews. Jesus was a black man and everything else. And you know, it's just as stupid and idiotic as white people saying it. So I'm not being racist by what I'm saying here. You're as big of an idiot if you're black as you are if you're white saying you're Jewish. So, but, you know, we're the true Jews. We're the true Jews. Okay. Then you have a piece of real estate over there in Israel. Very, very plain Israel and the capital city of Jerusalem. It's your land. Go on over and fight for it. Send me a postcard. Let me know how it goes. Okay. You know, big, brave, we're the true Jews. Okay. Get on an airplane and go over there and walk up to those Israeli soldiers and say, we're here for our land. Get off my property. God gave me a right. God gave me this land. I'm a true Jew. You're not. Let me know how it works. Okay? I mean, case closed, you know? People, could you do an in-depth study? I don't have to. Maybe I will someday, but it's like, I don't have to do an in-depth study on who the true Jews are. Why? Because they're on their land. Just as the Bible prophesied would happen. You know? Always cracks me up, you know? We're the true Jews. We're the true Jews. Okay, go over to Israel. Go over. You know, take lots of bulletproof clothing with you, please. Still not going to do you any good. But Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Okay? Now, again, there's, you know, some stuff there that's going to be for the people in the time of Jacob's trouble. But instruction in righteousness for Christians? Yeah, it's there. You know, again, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. Okay, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. That's a real challenge right now. Why? Well, because suffering is on the horizon for us as Christians. It's coming. I don't know what the timing of the rapture and things that we go, but it could get real rough before we leave. I've never taught that we're going to be leaving before any suffering happens. I've never taught that. But what's the advice? Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Martial law kicks in and whatever else, and bad things come, and a lot of Christians get killed and whatever. You get a martyr's reward. And I'm not saying you get a martyr's reward because you strap bombs to yourself and go blow something up. That's Islam. That's not Christianity, okay? If you do that, you're just stupid. You're not going to get anything. You're not going to prove anything. You're just going to make it worse for other Christians, All right, that's not the New Testament. Unless you're Stephen Anderson or some other moron like that that works for the Roman Catholic Church. But let's continue. Verse 11. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. He that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Okay? Again, we're seeing some of that works-based salvation creeping in here that's going to be into that time of Jacob's trouble. And like I said, a lot of this stuff, I'm just going like, scratching my head going, okay, you know, he that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. Well, I don't have to worry about things like that. I'm born again. All right? I don't have to overcome to be saved and get away from the second death thing there. I don't need that. All right? And you know, and of course you can spiritualize it. You can say, well, you see, the second death for a Christian would be that you die, you know, to yourself, you die to your self-righteousness, and then you get saved, and then you aren't hurt by the second death, meaning when you physically die because you get raptured up. And you can't steal a lot of this stuff from the book of Revelation and try to apply it to a Christian today doctrinally. Instruction in righteousness, yes. Reproof, correction, whatever, sure. But be careful. And I'm just not going to go through this and just simply say, well, I understand the whole thing. Dangerous. But look at verse 12, Revelation chapter 2, verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges. If you know your Bible, you know where I'm going. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. What is the sharp sword with two edges? Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and, turn the page, is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. This book, what did we read just there in Revelation chapter 2, verse 12? These things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges. You mean to tell me Jesus Christ himself would also use this book? This book is so important that the Lord Jesus Christ would say, it is written. And when he comes back, what does he use to fight against the Antichrist army with? A sharp two-edged sword comes out of his mouth. I've often wondered about that. Is it something new that the Lord says, and it's just because it's coming from him, it's like, has the authority of Scripture? Or is he quoting something from the Bible? How about that? He says something, and the whole army just wipes him out. It's a pretty powerful book we have here. Pretty amazing. Verse 13, Revelation chapter 2, verse 13. I know thy works, there it is again, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is. And thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. Oh boy. Now this is very interesting. Extremely interesting. Why? Was Antipas in heaven? No. Was he slain in heaven? No. Did Antipas somehow make it down to hell and Satan's down there on his throne? You see these drawings and stuff. And he got slain down there? No. Antipas died on the earth. Where does Satan dwell? Someplace on the earth. Where Satan's seat is. Show you something here really quickly. Job chapter 1. Go back to your Old Testament. Job chapter 1. This is probably one of the most interesting things in the entire Bible. Of course, you know, our King James Bible has so much in it that's just mind-blowing, you know. Kind of hard to say that one thing is very interesting. It's like the whole book's interesting, but this is pretty amazing. Job chapter 1, verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou? Then Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth, and from walking up and down in it. Physically walking around on the earth? Huh? Mm-hmm. But for you dumb Luciferians out there, atheistic Luciferians and things, and, you know, I'm a member of the Church of Satan, you know, okay. Do you realize what we just read there? Your God, Satan, has to report for duty before God Almighty and give an account of what he's doing. That's some God you have there, isn't it? I mean, has to submit himself to God the Father. And you think somehow he's cooler and more powerful or some kind of thing. He represents some kind of cool rebellion that you'd like to be part of or something. You're a fool. F-O-O-L. Fool. To worship a loser like Satan. My word. Oh, but you know he has special powers and things like that. Give me a break. You know? Ridiculous. But I want to make another point here. Go back to Revelation chapter 2. Another point I want to make. Satan in Job was walking around on the earth, but he has to report up to God in heaven. When does Satan get kicked out of heaven? Well, if you read Revelation chapter 12, that's when he gets kicked out. There's a war in heaven. Satan is, and he takes away a third of the angels, you know, in the rebellion. And he takes his angels and he fights against Michael and his angels and he loses and he gets cast down to the earth. So what does that mean for us as Christians? I've said about this in other studies, but you might not have seen those. That means when we get to heaven, Satan's going to be there. What? You know? Yeah, it's going to be weird. It's going to be real weird. You know, the Bible, it's interesting because the Bible talks about the accuser of our brethren. You know, and how he's cast down in Revelation chapter 12. That's where it talks about it. He accused them before the throne day and night. Wouldn't it be interesting if the devil was there at the judgment seat of Christ? He's kind of the prosecuting attorney. Something to think about. Weird, weird stuff. But what about this thing of Satan's seat? Well, if you do the study on it, you'll see this succession from the Caesars in Rome. They had a throne that they would sit on, and you know the area of Pergamus and everything else would have been, I forget the exact details of it, I was looking into it, and the important part is not where it was in the first century. The important part is, where is it today? And you see the fifth kingdom that's talked about in the book of Daniel. You know, the head of gold, the chest of silver, the, is it the thighs, I think it is, or belly or thighs or something like that, that are brass, and then the legs of iron, and then the toes, the feet there, the 10 toes, part of iron, part of miry clay. The fourth kingdom morphs into the fifth. Well, if you study history, the fourth kingdom is Rome, the Iron Legions of Rome, and it morphs into Roman Catholicism, which is exactly what happened. Constantine and some of these other guys, they went from being Pontificus Maximus, you know, to the Supreme Pontiff. The Pope is still called by that title today. It wasn't Peter, okay? They were the ones killing Peter, all right? You know, crucified him upside down and all that other stuff according to history and tradition and whatever. Probably that's what happened. But it's interesting because the Romans were the ones that killed Peter. And yet they say, oh, he was in Rome, he was a bishop of Rome, and things like this. Yeah, okay. You know, weird beliefs. But let me put up some pictures of what could possibly be this Satan's seat. I mean, here we have the thing of Pope John Paul II, as he was, before he died there, a little old ghoul sitting there, you know. And he's sitting there in this chair, and it's got the inverted cross. And of course, the Catholics will say, oh, that's the cross of Peter. It's the cross of Peter, symbolizing he was crucified upside down because he didn't feel worthy to be crucified right side up, and blah, blah, blah. Again, they're traditions of men. But it's also, inverted crosses are also signs of Satanism. And, you know, if you understand the occult, they do things for the uninitiated, but then the inner circle really knows what the symbol really means. I think that's what's going on there. Here's another throne, another seat. Could this be Satan's seat? How about this one? This one's creepy. Yeah, take a look at that one. That one would certainly qualify for Satan's seat. Interesting. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. What is the importance of this Satan's seat? 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4 says, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Satan manifest in the flesh, in the person of the Antichrist, that wicked, it talks about in verse 8. And that wicked sits in the temple of God. Where will the temple of God be in the time of Jacob's trouble? Jerusalem. I mean, Matthew chapter 24 talks about when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place. He stands and then he takes the seat. He takes the throne. Go back to Revelation chapter 13. Revelation chapter 13. Yeah, I got to find where this one is. I don't have this in my notes. The Lord just put this into my head. All right, found it. Sorry about that. Wasn't in my notes, but I'm trying to find it quickly. Revelation chapter 13, verse 2. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. Okay. You say, well, you're picking on Catholicism. How dare you pick on Catholicism? Go back to Revelation chapter 2 while I'm talking here. Okay. I won't pick on Roman Catholicism anymore. Please tell me another religion that has its leader sitting on a throne. A great seat with great authority and great power, where other religious leaders come and bow down to that power. If you don't think that the Pope is a very, very extremely powerful man, the most powerful man on earth, you are quite foolish. It's the Jews, it's the Jews. The Jews are servants, the high-level Jews, the Zionist, Illuminati Jews, whatever, they're servants of the Pope. That's why this big rabbi up in New York City accepted a papal knighthood. If the Jews are really in control and really in power, a high-level Jewish rabbi wouldn't need to go to the Pope and get knighted. He'd say, you're below us. I don't need you. The Vatican's in control, not the Jews. But let's go back to Revelation chapter 2, continuing here, verse 14 and 15. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Okay, what is this thing of this doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel? Okay, well, notice three things there. To eat things sacrificed unto idols, idolatry. To commit fornication, sex perversion. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate, a clergy above the people. You say, what? I don't understand what's going on. Well, what did Balaam do, without going into the whole big story? He knew that God was not going to go against his own people. So the idea comes up, well, if I can't get God to curse the Jewish people, I can get the Jewish people to sin and mess them up so that God is forced to punish them. It's exactly what the devil's been doing here in America. There are Christians, and the Lord's just not going to, he's going to say, hey, I'm not going to do anything to that Christian there. I'm going to bless them. But the devil comes along and he says, if I can turn America against God, God won't bless America anymore. God will be forced into a position where he has to correct them, has to punish them. Yeah. Interesting. Let's look at the judgment here. Revelation chapter 2, verse 16. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Again, Jesus Christ uses the standard of his written word to fight against wickedness and evil. Do you realize what you're holding in your hands, brethren? Do you realize how important it is? This book is the most powerful thing in the universe. Why? You say, well, is it more powerful than God? Well, you know, no, not in some ways, but in other ways, you know, God put it in writing. That's legally binding. I mean, you know, you put something in writing, you can get yourself in a lot of trouble if you violate that. And the God of the universe knows that. But he took a, well, he didn't really take a chance because he knows, you know, everything. But, you know, the fact of the matter is he did something very special, putting his truth in writing. It's amazing. Verse 17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it. Again, we have some doctrinal things there, kind of, eh. But what about instruction in righteousness? You are given hidden manna to eat. God will make sure to feed you. He'll take care of you. And he'll give you a white stone, and in the stone a new name written. You know, there's an old hymn, there's a new name written down in glory, you know, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. You know, you can be careful of that stuff. But turn in your Bible to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to show you some interesting spiritual tie-ins here. Instruction in righteousness, we'll say. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Says here, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Now, you don't necessarily have a new name in terms of God calls you some kind of a new name. I mean, he did with Paul. He was Saul, and then he became Paul. But you have a new life when you get saved. The Lord comes in, and he changes you. And all of a sudden, you find your interests changing. And your things that you used to love in the past, that starts to change. And your friends start to change. Your music changes. The way you dress changes. Your priorities change. Things start to change. Why? You're a new creature. Continuing. Revelation chapter 2, verse 18 and 19. And unto the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, and charity, and service, and faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first. Again, we're not going to go to it, but in the Gospels, Jesus talked about the first shall be last, the last shall be first. What is that? We read about it there earlier in the verse. Charity. Okay? Colossians chapter 3. What is the deal with charity? Colossians chapter 3 and verse 14 says, and above all these things put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness. if you're always thinking about the betterment of other people and always trying to do things for other people, you're going to do pretty good as a Christian. That's charity. Okay? It's self-sacrifice. It's you going out of your way to help other people. If you want to read 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the whole chapter sometime, that's the charity chapter in your King James Bible. The new versions say love. Love doesn't cut it. Love, the term love has been so abused and misused and everything else. And love just doesn't have that self-sacrificing thing that charity does. But, you know, there's a couple places in Scripture where you can read and kind of examine yourself. You know, it's kind of that mirror I talked about earlier, where you examine your life and you say, I've fallen from the Lord. You know, I've been messing around with some things and whatever. And 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is a good one. Okay. It's a good mirror, so to speak. When you read that and you examine your own life, you judge yourself so that you don't have to be judged of the Lord. You see? And you start to look and you say, am I really doing things out of charity? Do I really care about people? What's my motivation for service? Because if your motivation for serving the Lord is self-serving, if it's you're getting something for your flesh and it's building up in pride or it's whatever, it's going to burn up at the judgment seat of Christ. But when you have charity, the bond of perfectness, when you have that and you're serving the Lord, you know, willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind, as we read in 1 Peter chapter 5. When you're doing that, it's going to show up at the judgment seat of Christ as gold, silver, precious stones, and those things make it through the fire. The wood, hay, and stubble does not. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, if you're curious where that stuff's at. And I have a study on the judgment seat of Christ, too. You can listen to that. But let's continue. Revelation chapter 2. Verse 20 through 23. Here it gets interesting again, too. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Okay? I'm just going to be right out front. Again, comparing Scripture with Scripture. If you compare this to what's going on over in Revelation chapter 17, that Mystery Babylon, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth, she commits fornication with the kings of the earth and things. It's Roman Catholicism. There's no doubt. Her collars are purple and scarlet. It's the collars of Roman Catholicism, the bishops and the cardinals. Okay, I mean, look at any big Vatican processionals and things. It's purple and scarlet in abundance. All right, they are Mystery Babylon. They're Babylonian witchcraft practices that they've carried down through. So what happens when a Christian starts to hang out with the whore, starts to mess around with her, with Jezebel? See? And you start to get some of her teachings. You start to say, well, actually, the King James Bible isn't a perfect translation. Actually, I prefer the ESV. Where's the ESV come from? Well, ultimately, it ties back to the Vatican. Well, I prefer, you know, the more ancient Greek codices, B and Aleph, you know, and Alexandrinus and all these other things and stuff. Yeah, where does it come from? Where does it tie back to? The Vatican. The Vatican teaches doubt when it comes to the Word of God. They don't believe in sola scriptura, if you want to use the Latin. They don't believe in the Bible alone. What's going on there when a Christian starts to fall for that? Well, she's teaching and is seducing my servants, and you're committing fornication, spiritual fornication. You're joining with all these other wicked people. It's very dangerous. Verse 21, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. That, you know, I was reading that this morning, and I thought to myself, isn't it amazing how long the Lord has given the Roman Catholic Church? He's given them so long to repent. And she repented not. And I've seen this thing with Roman Catholics. There's a spirit, that Jezebel spirit that's there. And it's just like, you just try to witness to them and try to witness to them. And sometimes they'll get saved. praise the Lord for Catholics that get saved. They're some of my favorite converts. You know, I see Catholics and they say, brother, you know, I got saved and whatever under your ministry on, you know, watch the salvation message and, you know, put my faith in Jesus Christ. I'm out of the whole Catholic system. It's wicked. I'm out of there. Never going back. Praise the Lord. That makes my day. But there are a lot of other Catholics. I mean, you just can't get anywhere with them. God gives them space to repent, but they don't do it very often. Verse 22, behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds. And I will kill her children with death. She's the mother of harlots. The mother of harlots. She has daughters? They call them Protestants. We're protesting what our mother is doing. We want to reform it. And then they come out and they do the same things that the mother is doing. Just with a few little tweaked, little added differences and things like this. And what's happening? Well, our text there says, I will kill her children with death. We're seeing all these Protestant denominations dying. Oh, and you know, the Baptists out there are screaming, we're not Protestants, we're not Protestants. Yes, you are. Well, you know, the Baptists of the past, the Anabaptists. You're not an Anabaptist. Roger Williams, he was a Baptist. Roger Williams never identified himself as a Baptist. Okay? He was meeting with people out in the woods, out in the fields. It wasn't until after his death that somebody else came and had a building built there with the group that he had started, that Roger Williams had started. And by the way, Roger Williams left them. And John Smythe and all these other guys that are now today identified as Baptists, but yet you look at what these guys were doing, it's nothing at all like the modern day Baptists. And I'm talking independent, fundamental, Bible-believing Baptists. I'm not talking Southern Baptist or American Baptist or whatever. I'm talking IFB. That's what I'm talking about. Just another daughter of the harlot. You do things that are the same as the Roman Catholic Church. You got the same buildings. You have a lot of the same standards. You're doing the same things in practice many times. What's going on? I will kill her children with death. Why do you think all these Protestant denominations are dying? And they're all going right back to Rome, back to their mother. Yep, more on that later. Another study coming up. And all the churches shall know that I am he which searcheth the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. There it is again. Going to judge you according to your works. Verse 24. But unto you I say, and unto the rest in Thyatira, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden. Another very interesting thing. You see, because in the midst of all these children of the harlot, and they're all going back, and they're all committing fornication, and they're all just like, you see so many groups of Christians, you know, I hate to use the term churches because people think, oh, it's a building and, you know, the whole deal. But all of these different groups, and you see them, they're all doing just such wickedness, and you're just like going, I can't believe they're doing this. I can't believe they're saying this. I can't believe I just heard so-and-so. I thought he was a legitimate preacher. I thought he was a good guy. And he just totally went back to Rome. He's like totally just using new versions now, which come from the Vatican, and they're doing this and they're doing that. And you're just going like, oh, you know. But you see, that's where verse 24 comes in. As many as have not this doctrine. What doctrine? Jezebel. As many as have not this doctrine, as many as are saying, I'm not going to have any part of that Roman Catholic junk. If you want to do that, I'm out. I'm not leaving the Baptist church, my local church. I'm not leaving it because I don't like the color of the carpet or because I don't like the way certain people dressed on the one Sunday and it offended me, or something like this, or I don't like the pastor has his laugh is kind of annoying or something. No. I'm leaving because I see shades of Roman Catholicism in this building. I'm out of here. They have not that doctrine there, and which have not known the depths of Satan as they speak. Again, very interesting. The depths of Satan as they speak. I mean, there's just so much in this book, it's amazing. You know, Satan's ministers coming along and they're saying things, they appear as the ministers of righteousness, and you go, wait a second, that doesn't sound right. Oh, come on, don't make problems. Don't just be quiet. Just shut your mouth. You know, don't be judgmental. Don't be whatever. I'm leaving. See, you can be in the midst of a very wicked nation where all the churches are just falling apart and just people are doing things that are wicked. And you can be in the midst of that nation and just say, I am not part of that. Not at all. And what's the Bible say? I will put upon you none other burden. So the Lord's saying, hey, these rebukes that are here for this church, I'm not going to put those on you because I see you're not taking part of it. I will put upon you none other burden. God will bless you in the midst of a wicked and perverse nation. Daniel's a perfect example of that. Daniel was greatly blessed. And he was living in the very first New World Order. The most powerful of all of them. Where the word of Nebuchadnezzar was law. Pretty amazing. And yet God blessed him in that time. God can bless you as a Christian right now. If you're willing to, take some decisive action to live for the Lord. If you're willing to step out in faith and live for Him and stand by His Word, no matter what it costs you. Turn back to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Second Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14 through 18. It says here, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God, as God hath said, I will dwell in them, and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. And will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. If you haven't come out yet, you better get out soon. You say, of what? The Babel buildings? Oh, no, brother. Oh, God. You have to go off on this again. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. They're unscriptural. They're heretical. They're terrible, terrible places. And you're going in there, and you are unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Nowhere in Scripture was anybody ever told to build a building and invite the lost to it. Nowhere. You are in violation of these verses. You say, well, it's about marriage. It's about marriage. We're not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers in the sense of marriage. It has nothing to do with marriage, other than maybe instruction in righteousness. I mean, it's a good idea to marry somebody that's saved. Sure. But 1 Corinthians chapter 7 talks about people that are married to lost, you know, husband or lost wife, depending on what you are. And it says you're not to put them away if you're pleased to dwell together. It's not talking about marriage. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14 through 18 is talking about where you worship the Lord. The people that you congregate with. And when you see all this wickedness, when you see the doctrines of Jezebel, the Roman Catholic Church, and you realize, oh wait, I'm in one of her daughters. A daughter of the Mother Church. Isn't it interesting, too, when you have Baptist churches, a lot of times they'll talk about, We just started a sister church. Giving feminine aspects to a church. I wonder why that would be. Isn't that kind of weird? Well, that's our sister church over there. Oh, you mean another daughter of a mother? Oh, yeah. Revelation chapter 2. Go back there. Revelation chapter 2, verse 25. But that which ye have already, hold fast till I come. I like that one too. That which ye have already. In other words, you can have things that have been around for a long time. The things that you have, the old saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. If it's not broken, don't get something new. This King James Bible's been around for a long time. Greatest book that's ever been written. The things which you have already, hold fast till I come. You'd be so much more effective if you used a new version. Nope. Say, give me that King James Bible. Nope. I'm going to hold fast. Well, the other ones are more accurate. No, they're not. It's kind of funny because they say they're more accurate, and yet when you look at the text that they're supposedly more accurate to, they don't even dare translate the whole text. The Greek texts, the manuscripts of Aleph and B, add apocryphal books as part of the inspired text, and yet the new versions, most of them don't do that. So they say our new versions are more accurate. You say to what? Well, Vaticanus and Sinaiticus. Really? So you translate them totally? No. Then how are they more accurate? Stupid nonsense is what that is. Turn back to Proverbs 23:23. Back to the Old Testament. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 23. Good verse here, very interesting. Buy the truth and sell it not. Also wisdom and instruction and understanding. Very important. Buy the truth and sell it not. You say, well, I'm going to have to spend money? Well, in some ways, yes. You have to buy Bibles and sometimes you have to buy books and things like that. But there's another way to buy the truth, and that is with your time. Time is money. After all, it's going to cost you something to stand for this book and to study this book. Back when I was studying for the ministry, I remember there were so many times where it was just a beautiful day and I wanted to get outside and I wanted to just take a walk and I just wanted to go whatever. And there were many, many times I sat there and I just studied and studied and I read and I looked out the window and it was dark. I've been at it all day. What was I doing? Buying the truth. He say, have you sold it yet? No. Not going to sell it. I'm not going to be a sellout Christian. Well, I used to be King James only, but I studied it and now I'm not. No. Nope. Buy the truth and sell it not. Thought this was kind of interesting too. What is the verse there? Chapter and verse. Proverbs 23:23. 2 times 3 is what? 6. 2 times 3 is what? 6. How many books in the Bible? 66. Probably nothing to it though, don't worry about Revelation chapter 2. We'll finish up here. Revelation chapter 2, verse 26 through 29. He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall they be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. And I will give him the morning star. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. Now, you know, I read that the first time, you know, and, well, long time ago, but I'm saying, you read this thing and you go, well, the one that's ruling the nations with a rod of iron, that's Jesus. So why, I don't understand, how could this, at the end there, be for, you know, Jesus? And you kind of get confused there, but it's like, but just read the text there, you know, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, as the vessels of a potter shall be broken to shivers, even as I received of my Father. So Jesus is comparing, there's a Christian, there's somebody that's saved, and, you know, and a saved individual, I'll say it that way, and they rule and reign with Christ for the millennial kingdom. And they rule very similar to the way the Lord rules and reigns. That's what's going on there. Verse 28, and I will give him the morning star. The morning star is Jesus. We'll go back to Psalm 2. We'll show you this scripture tie-in about ruling and reigning with a rod of iron. And that's where we're going to end it for today. Psalm 2. And I thought this would be a very appropriate place to end our study because of a lot of the stuff that's going on in the world today and the news and everything else. Psalm 2, verse 1. Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh. The Lord shall have them in derision. Get that one. God's not only laughing at them, he's deriding them. He has got has them in derision. He's making fun of them, in other words. So, you know, a lot of times people get confused as to why I make fun of certain individuals or groups or people or whatever else, for the same reason the Lord does. There are some people that are just plain down foolish, and you don't owe them any respect. If anybody comes to this ministry and talks to me and they're a sinner and they're like, hey, I'm really having trouble with this, I'm not going to make fun of them if my life depended on it. No way. I will be gentle. I mean, watch the majority of my preaching. I'm very, very gentle with a lot of what I say. But when I see somebody who knows the truth and who persists in teaching against the truth, knowing it and studying it and things, I'm going to be very brutal with that person. Why? Same thing that the Lord does. And what comes after him laughing and making fun of them? Verse 5, then shall he speak unto them in his wrath and vex them in his sore displeasure. He shall do what? Speak unto them in his wrath? What's the tie into the New Testament? When does God get rid of all this new world order, all the kings of the earth setting themselves and taking counsel together, the United Nations and all this other stuff? When does the Lord destroy that? Revelation chapter 19. What comes out of his mouth? A sharp two-edged sword. He shall speak, then shall he speak unto them in his wrath. How about that? Yeah. Verse 6. Yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree. The Lord hath said unto me, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. Ask of me, and I shall give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost parts of the earth for thy possession. Anybody that comes along and says, well, I'm post-millennial, or I'm amillennial, or I'm preterist, or I'm this, or I'm that. Anybody other than a premillennial believer, in other words, that Jesus comes back before the millennial kingdom and he rules and reigns physically on the earth, anybody that teaches anything else is trying to steal the inheritance that God promised to his son. Very dangerous place to be. Verse 9, here's the tie-in to what we read in Revelation chapter 2. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron, thou shalt dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Be wise now, therefore, O ye kings, be instructed, ye judges of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry, and ye perish from the way, when his wrath is kindled but a little. Blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Well, we read in the first study that you're blessed for reading the prophecies of the book of Revelation. Now we read here, blessed are all they that put their trust in him. Let me ask you a question, Christian. Do you trust God? You say, well, sure, brother, I trust God. Do you trust him with what's coming? Oh, yeah. I know what goes through your heads. You know why? Because it goes through my head. I look and I see mainstream media framing Bible-believing Christians, having King James Bibles sitting around and saying, oh, this is hate preachers, and these hate preachers, and they hate people, and they're very much almost like terrorists. And the handwriting's on the wall. Persecution's coming. Definitely. What about world war? We're on the brink of major, massive world war. Iran is continually provoking the U.S. Navy ships. I think the Strait of Hormuz or something like this. I think I've been hearing about this and things. Firing missiles, buzzing the boats and stuff like this, trying to get the Navy to fire at them, which would trigger world war. Russia, huge big war room. I had a brother send me this information. It was just like, you know, built this, Putin has got this huge big war room and they're planning all this stuff. They're moving, you know, intercontinental ballistic missiles and things to the borders of Ukraine, and they're doing this and they're doing that, and they're posturing for war. North Korea is sending up missiles and launching test missiles and test nukes and everything else, causing earthquakes in South Korea because of their test nukes going off. And you're going like, whoa, what's going on here? Well, if you fear the Lord, he'll keep you safe. You say, well, brother, what happens if there's war? He can keep you safe through it. What happens if there's a police state? What about? He can keep you safe. We have precious promises that we can stand on. We know how things end up. And let me just say this again, just to kind of reiterate the point I was making earlier. If you've left your first love, repent. Remember what it was that, or where and when, I should say too, when you fell. Did you put the book down? Did you pick the remote up for the television? Get back. Get that first love back, where all you want to do is think about Jesus and talk about Jesus and just spend every waking moment that you have talking to him. Don't waste your time singing the songs of this world. I know it's difficult. Good night. I mean, those of us that have been saved later in life, you know, you go, I got saved when I was 25, so I had plenty of years of listening to secular rock music, and it's like there's a grocery store down in Holton down below us, and they always play like classic rock from the 1980s, and it's like, you know, I go in there and it's just like, oh brother, this song, you know, vexing. I don't go there very often. It's rough sometimes, brethren, but in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I know I always say this, Lord, in the prayers, but it's just so true. I thank you so much for this book, this King James Bible, and the eternal truths that it contains. It doesn't need to be updated. This book is so up to date, it's scary sometimes how accurate it is to explaining what we all go through as Christians. I just thank you, Lord, so much for this, that we're not left down here to be blind, just stumbling around in the dark. And Lord, I just want to pray for my brothers and sisters in Christ out there, that they would be encouraged, and that they would not faint or grow weary, but that they would continue to press forward and witness to people as they can, and read your word and stand by your word, stand by your truth. And Lord, if there's anybody out there that has fallen away and has gotten mixed up in sin, Lord, I pray that today would be the day that they come back. today would be the day that they get things sorted out between you and them, that they would confess their sins. And if they're not saved, Lord, if they don't know for sure that they're saved, then I pray that they would get that worked out. And I just thank you, Lord, for the freedom to be able to preach your word to a lot of people around the world. And I just pray, Lord, that you would keep the doors open as long as possible. And I ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay. Going to be working on Revelation chapter 3 coming up. There's other studies and things that are coming into the picture here. And I have kind of another reason for putting my banner here. And that is, as you can see, I'm moving some of the things around, restructuring the ministry. Basically going to be moving ministry type operations to another room here and moving things all around. So it's always a challenge, you know, but it's good. So definitely want to be a lot more efficient. And, you know, again, I just want to reiterate that thank you to everybody that prays for the ministry, everybody that donates to the ministry, keeps us going. We're going to keep putting videos out as long as we can. If we ever get kicked off YouTube, I don't know, we'll do something else. As far as ministry type of things are concerned, I want to stay in the fight up until the time the Lord catches us away. But, you know, I just want to say, I know that there are lost people that have been watching, and you see something here in this ministry and you say, this guy makes some interesting points. It's not this guy. It's not me. It's the Holy Spirit. And if you're lost, the Holy Spirit will give you glimpses of truth. You won't understand the whole Bible. Why? Well, because 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 talks about it. You're not going to receive the things of the Spirit of God. You're the natural man. Bible talks about you're not spiritual. Things that are in the Bible are spiritually discerned. But if you're seeing things here and you're saying, I don't quite understand some of the things that you're saying, well, there's a good chance that you're not saved. And I am not saying everything I say is perfect and infallible and whatever else. I mean, watch the studies long enough, you'll see the proof of that. But I make plenty of mistakes. But I just want to really reiterate this thing. There's nothing more important than your soul, than eternity. Where are you going to go when you die? You say, well, I prayed a prayer way back when. I have a good feeling. Good feelings aren't going to cut it. Don't gamble with eternity like that. Don't think to yourself, well, you know, I'm pretty sure. You have to be 100% sure. And you can know that you are saved. All right? For years and years and years, I lived like that. I prayed a prayer of salvation when I was 8 years old in the Sunday school at the Babel building I was raised in, and forced to go to church every time the doors were open, the whole deal. And I thought, well, I'm a Christian. And I lived that way up until the time I was 25 years old. And I was just confronted with it, and I thought, you know, I don't know. I really don't know if I would go to heaven. I don't know 100%. Yes, I'm going to go to heaven when I die. I'm living like the world. I can't relate to the people in the Bible. There's some things I understand, but a lot it's a mystery to me. And I got saved. God saved me. I wasn't going around saying I've prayed the prayer, I've saved myself from going to hell. No, God saved me. Make sure that you get your salvation figured out. All right? That's going to be it. Well, thank you for watching. And we will see you in the next study. I'm not sure if it's going to be another video or Revelation chapter 3. So that's going to be it. Thank you for watching.